You play flute also?
Yeah, I do.
Wow, that's fantastic.
I'm not that great, though. You guys, too cute. Love it. Really cute, man. Oh, that's for later.
Oh, yeah.
Let me just get you up
I'm not
here.
that great, though.
Hold on. Okay. And here I am. Hi, Joyce. Joyce is joining us and just doing my little arrangement there. There we go. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, my guest today is my friend Alfonso Rodenas. Rodane, how do you pronounce it?
Well, in Espanol, we say Rodenas.
Rodenas.
Yeah, you said
Rodenas,
perfectly. Perfectly
perhaps.
pronounced Rodenas. But I imagine that people here say Rodenas. Rodenas, yeah, it's okay.
Yeah,
Yeah.
whatever.
Yeah.
I'm so glad you like that because I really, it annoys me when people get annoyed over their name pronunciation.
Yes, I don't care that much.
I don't either.
Oh, I understand that the R letter, it's very difficult to pronounce for Anglo-Saxons, so I don't really care, you know what I mean. I hope they don't care about my mispronunciation also, because after 20 years, some people don't understand a single word I say. It's like, how is this possible? I feel so, oh yeah. 20 years, yeah.
Alfonso and I met by he is the engineer for Dennis Dreif, who some of you out there know, and Dennis is a composer and gosh, he's done so much. He's worked in capacities of protecting musicians' money and he's arranged and he has a studio. Anyway, so I was doing work at the studio and Alfonso is the engineer. And I was so happy to meet him and experience his work. Really wonderful, wonderful engineer.
Thank you.
And then I discovered he was also a musician of all different instruments, singer. He has this group with his love, as you probably could tell when they kissed.
Yes.
I'm going to ask which came first, the chicken or the egg? So, did you as a musician come first, or you as an engineer?
I think both things came very kind of like together somehow. I was, first of all, like as a child, I was a big music lover. My brothers were presenting me with all this amazing music. And I was always very interested in make the record player sound as better as possible. You know, I remember putting like 25 cents coins on top of the needle head, you know, because it was producing more bass and it was sounding more beautiful. So, and I remember, you know, always touching the azimuth in the tape recorders, all those things, you know. Definitely was before the musician thing. Yeah, I have a little band with my young brother in my little town, and we were into music, into emulating our rock bands and all that. It's because I was in music that we won one of those city contests, rock contests.
Really?
Yeah, one of the awards was visiting this best facility in town and making recording there. And I always wanted to participate of that and to be an engineer also and all that. It was so attractive to me. And I quit the job that I had at the time and just jumped myself into that small narrow window that was presented to me in that studio. Yeah, and that was the starting point. So it was before was the probably the chicken. I don't know. The chicken or the egg. I don't know. But they all went together all the time. When I became engineer, I was fully engineering. I quit the band and everything because it was so demanding and I had to learn so much. And then after a while, I became the chief engineer in this same facility. And I'm working 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. So I could not keep with that and rehearsals and concerts and gigs and thinking of music. In music. So I quit for a big while till the point that I thought that I was never gonna come back to music. And it was then I came to the US and it was because I wasn't working that much because nobody knew about me and this and that, that I grabbed a guitar again and I started playing songs. And then with Victoria, she's a wonderful lyricist. She asked me to help her to make songs, and then I was bit by the poison of music and artistry and all that again, you know. But that's what I do. I do music and engineering as a professional, mostly engineering, of course.
I want to ask questions about the engineering. I guess, you know, my husband was a lighting board operator on the Tonight Show. And he, when I met him and we talked about it, he used to say, you know, it went along with what I knew in music too, but he used to say, it's not, there are some, there's techniques and there's right and wrongs, but then there's just opinions, you know, your view of this and my view of this. So, I guess that's a, that, you know, that must be a typical engineer point of view, right? I mean, right,
Yes.
you know what you want and you know what you like. And
Yes. I mean, engineering is engineering also because of it's a very technical thing.
yeah.
I mean, there is opinions in how to place a microphone. There are opinions in how to mix or give the acoustic treatment to signals and that, but at the same time, it's very technical. So the audio path have to be as best as possible. You know what I mean? The
Yeah.
levels, the captured, all that is very technical. So there are opinions, but at the same time it has to be very precisely done. And there is no margin to do it bad or wrong. Have to be well done. At
Yeah.
that point, from a well captured sound, you can go any direction, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's strictly a technical thing, at least in the recording environment, you know, the mixing, the production, that sort of thing. And of course, the placement of microphones, this and that, but there is so much literature regarding these technical matters. And then we enter into the taste, into the colors, into what you think is better sound or not or whatever.
Yeah.
Everybody has his own references, you know
Yeah.
what I mean? So some people Steely Dan albums are the best ever produced on record. For some people is the Sex Pistols albums, you know what I mean? So
Yeah.
then that's another thing. But
Well,
even at that point, the engineer have to continue doing a very technical job.
yeah.
You know what I mean? It's very creative in the sense that you can go into the artistic, into the painting, into this, but you have to know how to mix and to blend the colors and to continue treating the signal as a specifically, you know what I mean, in
Yeah.
the best possible way.
Yeah, there's an awful lot to it. I say a few things come to mind. Well, first of all, I think Larry Klein's producing is outstanding and it has his watermark. You know, he's like, I don't know, obviously I don't know how he does it exactly, but there's a space that occurs on his albums. Like, I don't know if you heard Billy Child's record, the Laura Nero record that he did. Did you ever hear that?
Back in the day, in the
No,
70s.
this was just a few years back.
Ah, no, I haven't heard it.
It's called Map to the Treasure. Check it out sometime. It's such a beautiful recording, playing, and the sound is really beautiful. And it's very Larry Klein. He has. It's the space, you know. It's really
It is,
quite
yeah.
wonderful. And so, but yeah, I can imagine that it's a very personal touch, like the Alfonso Rodenas, you know,
Maybe
touch.
I what we say in Espanol is probably everybody say in English too. It's like cada maestrillo tiene su librillo, which means that each teacher, each master has his own little book. You
Oh,
know what I mean?
what a beautiful
Where
line.
he teaches, he teaches from that book. It's the book of the experience. It's the book of his knowledge, and it's very particular to him. And we share many of those things of that book. But then there are experiences that you have that no one else have, you know what I mean? So
Yeah,
every
yeah.
teacher has his own book. And I imagine that that book make its own style or engineering or artistic personality. You know, in the end, all these again comes from a technical knowledge. Because let's say to create space, you have to master a time delays or reverberation or panning or mic techniques to put elements in different stages of depth and things like that. So you paint with the colors and the techniques that you know. In this case, this producer, he knows those techniques and he mastered those techniques like nobody else, and he applies those techniques. Others, maybe we don't have that same little book, and we try to do it in our own way, you know. But also, and this is because this is engineering, because it's coming from a technical, very precise world, you know what I mean? And science and technology, all this thing of the engineering is coming from very precise audio electronics and physics. So
What new things come to your attention in engineering? Do new things come to your attention? New pieces of equipment or new information about something that you know about?
well, I think audio engineering is evolving. It's been evolving constantly. Since the advent of digital technologies, some elements that before were only available to Holy Grail studios and facilities, like vintage compressors and equipment and this and that. Now, with the digital technologies, that is available to everybody. So everybody is using it in a different way. Also, maybe this is contradictory to what I said before. Also, one rule of engineering is don't tell me how have you done it. If it ends up sounding beautiful or well or gorgeous, that's what it is. I don't know if you have break the rule of compression and you are over compressing, and because of that, this sound come to life and it's gorgeous. So I don't care if you were overriding or over stressing the tape or whatever. You know what I mean? In the end, it sounds fantastic. So we don't care. That's a very well known, if not the most important rule of all the engineering thing. I don't care how you did it. If it sounds okay, it sounds okay. I'm saying this because
That being said, when you listen to something, can you listen without wondering what they did?
well, it's very interesting. That is very interesting because I have to switch my mind into analyzing production. My first approach or my automatic approach is listen music as a music lover or as a musician or as an artist. So I see the song and I see the music. And then if I want to go into it, then I start listening. Oh, okay. From a technical perspective. What I mean? And I think there are different minds. I don't know if they are departing from different brain levels, you know what I mean? But one thing is to listen to music, analyzing, oh, how beautiful this is sounding, how he put the cymbals like this or that, whatever thing, you know. And it's interesting. There are some musicians that they favor working with art, with a more artistic approach from the engineer. And people, oh, I like you very much because, no, as an example, I like you very much because you are listening like if you are a musician, an artist, you understand what I wanna, you know what I mean? And there are other engineers that are more super technical, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and then like I was speaking to a friend of mine who she and her husband are fantastic jazz artists, and they brought a project to a guy who is highly renowned for very big more pop stuff, but like very notable. And he Not only did he not really know what to do with the project, he actually told them to probably redo the project, which is totally absurd because the guy who he was telling was like a top player and his music is beautiful. So yeah, really interesting that too, you know. I mean, again, you're different from this other engineer and my sensibilities for what I like or, you know, are going to lead me to one of you, you know.
It's very interesting. I think it's very interesting. I think there is very ballsy people out there.
Yeah.
In the sense that they, oh, this is the way I do it. You have to redo the project because it's,
yeah,
you know what I mean? And then there is other people that work more for the service of the artists.
Yeah.
Is more able to bow to knee to what the artist's vision is,
yeah,
more than his own vision.
Mm-hmm.
I do understand that high end top producers, they are what they are because they have a vision and the way they do things is like this. And hey, if it doesn't match, you have to redo it. You know what I mean? But there are other producers, engineers that they completely follow the vision of the artist because it's the artist in the end.
Yeah.
What you are dealing with, you have to help him bring his vision. But I mean, there is not a rule because maybe there are artists that need guidance.
Yeah, sure.
To go to certain places and they can bring it to this point. But from that point on, they need to fully this, you know what I mean? So,
yeah,
also,
I know. I think it's a really interesting point, actually, you know. And that's the kind of engineers I like. I like engineers who are, well, most of the engineers I've worked with have been musicians. But even like the one, another one that I like, let's see. Oh, no, he was a musician too. Yeah. Some of them are a little bit more bold, you know, in their suggestions. Some aren't. And I mean, as the artist, I have to trust the engineer, you know, I have to trust them.
Well, it's just like the engineer is sort of the designated driver.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Engineer has to make things happen and go to places.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It can't work with the artist, it can't work with the producer, sometimes it's in the middle, sometimes the engineer is producer himself.
Yeah.
Sometimes the engineer is a part of the band. You know what I mean? But sort of the engineer is the designated driver.
Yeah.
Has full-fledged responsibility.
Yeah.
In what's going on, because in the end, he is in command of the thing, you know?
Yeah.
The engineer is always engineer's fault. You have heard that also, right?
No, so, but that, you know, makes sense.
The producer
that it's said like that.
Well, someone has to carry that also.
Yeah. Oh God.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the position of producer, you know, no matter how high or low it is, you know, or how much involvement it is. It's, you know, it's a challenge because of all those things you said, you know, what does the artist want? What should the artist want? What do you think is quality as the producer? Or how can you communicate this and get the job done? I remember one time I brought in a drummer for a project who was great live, but in the studio, he was terrible. And I was kind of shocked, and the engineer who was a musician, he said, you know, just because they're great live doesn't mean they're going to be great in the studio. And he knew that, you know, from experience, but I didn't know that because I hadn't really experienced it that much, you know.
But, very very different environments.
Yeah
They require different qualities out of the musician and the performer.
How do you, for me, it took me a long time, and I don't know if I'm still even 100% comfortable. Took me a long time to get comfortable singing in the studio, and it wasn't just because of the sound I was hearing. It was getting to that same place that I could get to live, the magical place, and maybe not analyzing, not hearing and analyzing. And maybe that I always produce myself, so maybe a producer would be good for me, to say, that's fine, or no, you could do it again, But how do you have any hints for that? You must have seen a million people go through that.
I mean, we are talking about singers. It's a very challenging situation being in front of a microphone and being recording. And, oh, here it comes. Now we are recording. Now we are recording the vocals. And now is my all that thing, It's very challenging for the artist, and it's a moment of a very so much importance because it's the end of the it's the most important part of the whole production, it's in, it's very difficult to take that challenging tension out of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But from the point of view of an engineer, you have to just make it as out of stress as possible. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not that you have an opportunity, you can have 19 takes. Just take it easy, it will come. You find your way. We are here with you. Take it easy. Start, warm up, get there. You know better than anybody else where you are doing all right and where you are not doing all right, how close you are to your ideal performance, how far you are in when you are getting there, the take that this is the take, but I make a mistake here, I can do that better. You know what I mean? As an artist and as a performer, you are the one that knows that better than anybody else. You know what I mean? So if someone in the other side of the mirror starts to be too opinionated too soon in the process, that makes things very complicated. You know what I mean? To me as a performer, because I am also singing, and as an engineer, I think the vocalists need a space. Need a space to make mistakes, to warm up, to doing it not the right way, and to keep going till he or she start feeling like I'm warming up, this is starting to come now. And then he has to make the people on the other side of the room, hey, you can start recording now or take care of these takes. You know what I mean? Nobody else but you know how close you are to what you want. You know what I mean? And at that point, when you think that you have made it and you are there, okay, what do you think? Sure, yeah. You're gonna start accepting suggestions in order to go or to press more here, to there, to, you know what I mean? So that requires a space and time for the artist and the team that is the other side of the glass. Allow that to happen. So that's the only way that the artist is gonna feel like it's getting into its space, her space, his space, and its groove, and all that. If not, it's very difficult. If just the first take, oh no, you should not do the. Yeah, give me a second. You know what I mean? Just parting here, you know. I think
Well,
so.
and that kind of brings to mind too how let's see, what's the word? Change, I guess the word is changing, you could listen to something you did, on Monday at 2 o'clock and really like it, and then at 5 o'clock listen and you don't like it, and then at 8 o'clock you like it again. That just makes me laugh, but anyway, but there is, I think every time there's something really magical, every time you hear it, you hear the magic. So it's, there are choices that you can make along the way. But I agree with you as far as space and time and giving yourself or giving the singer, this space to do it and to not feel like this, I have to do it right this time. And maybe that's why I never was good, like as a studio singer, It's like, this time is it. You have to be perfect, it's
It's
just
just like we are coming also from the from I was gonna say tradition. It's not tradition, but back in the day when you have, or now even in high-end productions, if you are going to a studio, if the studio is charging $300 per hour and the
Yeah.
click is tick tick tack tack tuk tick tick, oh my God, bro, you have to go and do it as soon as possible because it's clicking, and then you have to do four more songs or whatever. You know
Yeah.
what I mean? I mean, there is a time constraint that is pressurizing the performance and the delivery, and
Yeah.
that is rolling off all the naturality of the performance
Yeah.
somehow.
Yeah.
There is also some people that they like to work under the gun
Yeah.
and under that pressure, and they
Yeah.
feel pressurized, and they bring the best out of them. So it's just like, once again, there is no one rule
Yeah.
that measures everything. So some people need this and some people need that. And I think is part of the job of the engineer and of course the producer to realizing that and to accommodate the artist and the session to towards that goal. You know what I mean? But regarding what you were saying before, now I like it, now I don't like it. I think there is a point that the artist has to bestow the producer the responsibility
Yeah.
of like, yes, we agree that this is great, this is great. In 2 hours it's great. Believe me, don't
Yeah.
second guess yourself, you know what I mean?
Right.
Because tomorrow you are gonna second guess yourself. And there is people that they are not able to listen to the recordings ever again.
Yeah.
Joni Mitchell is famous because she hates to hear herself and in her records. Many people, not
Yeah.
just her, that's an
Yeah.
example.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, that is fruit of that session at that moment. That doesn't mean that it was my best me, or that doesn't mean that it is the only way of expressing those lyrics or those feelings. You know what I mean? It's
Yeah, I do.
like you have to capture and you have to put it there, and that's what a recording is.
Yeah.
That's part of the stress that a recording environment brings. The fact that this is forever,
Yeah.
with its good things and with its bad things, I have to do it as best as possible because that's the way it's going to be encapsulated.
Yeah.
While live performance is just radically opposed. It's a fruit of the moment, and I can come from this moment, but now I'm here. And this is a God tells you are just here, not there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Mediocre performance can rise into a very brilliant ones.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And this is what it is at the moment. Doesn't matter where you are coming from. In a studio, it's different. Because the studio, that is the performance, that's where it is, and that is where whatever, you know?
Yeah.
So the performer is very conscious of that. And it's, I imagine, and it's very difficult to take that stress out of the whole situation. But once again, with the new technologies and all these things, we should feel more comfortable
Yes.
that somehow, if we want, we can fix so many things.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, yeah. I mean, I always tell my students who are, going to record, you can change anything except the emotion. Everything's changeable. You can shift the line, you can break up the line, you can tune it, you can add color or whatever. But without your emotion carrying it, you can. Might as well just not do it.
We're realizing that the most important thing is the emotion.
Yeah.
Something can be perfect, and oh yeah, it's perfect. But if it's not transmitting that emotion,
Yeah.
right? Those is doesn't worth anything.
Yeah, I know. Sorry, I
And
was just answering
as far
myself.
as we know, there is not any plugin that can put emotion into something that is flat emotionally, right?
Right.
About, you know.
Sorry, I'm answering a question. He tries to just listen. Yeah, we actually had Roland asking a question that we had talked about before, like when you listen, do you listen as an engineer or as a listener? Yeah, there's so many questions I have. This is not a recording thing, and I don't know if you do live performances too, but when I was into the Grateful Dead years ago, I was so impressed with that wall of sound, that they had. Well, I mean, they didn't call it a wall of sound, I think. Somebody else called the wall of sound, maybe. Yeah, I forget who that was, but
Spectrum.
yeah. But the Grateful Dead had floor to ceiling amplifiers. And the sound was, pa-da-da. It was like soft. They must have had each amplifier on this much or something. And it was fantastic. It
Yes.
was gorgeous. I don't know. I don't know if that translates into studio stuff too, but live it was.
Probably has to do with compressions and dynamics and the treatment of all those things, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Of headroom to accommodate big expression, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's very important in recordings, and I imagine it's very important in live performance. I don't know exactly the Grateful Dead, how they were treating the live mix.
Yeah, I wonder if that translated somehow into the studio. As I recall, I haven't listened to them in years, but as I recall, their records were really sounded good. I haven't listened to them in a long time though.
Yes.
So here's a question that I'm, this is probably an endless question
They
too,
call it here.
but what do you think of the industry as far as making more records, making more recordings? What do you think of what's going on and where it's headed? And as an engineer and an artist, what do you think?
What do I think?
Yeah. Are we gonna see anything different? I mean, I did hear that something is up for a vote in the Senate regarding streaming revenue. So instead of making 0.0002 cents per song, you're gonna make 0.1 cent, which is great. You're still not going to get rich, but still, it's much better.
There is so much to talk about
Yeah.
all this situation of the industry and where the music is going and the music production and the making records and all these things, you know what I mean? There's so much to talk about it. What is clear is like big industry can break new artists at a global level as they were doing 60 years ago.
Yeah.
They can continue doing the same thing, all
Yeah.
right? And what it's clear is like the production methods to make a recording possible, and to put an output of work as an artist has been democratized so much that anybody can put records out there. You
Yeah.
know what I mean? There are many more artists than ever before,
Yeah.
in history.
Yeah.
And I'm talking about not just the musicians, I'm talking about photographers, painters, this and that, whatever discipline of artistic creation. The new technologies have made everything available to everybody.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to convey is the idea that there is no middle class in this anymore. It was back in the day, there was a middle class of musicians and musicianship that they could make a honest living out of their recordings. You know what I mean? Out of the little tours around the country, out of the selling of CDs in the concerts, you know what I mean? And then, of course, there were the top artists that they were making the business. And then there were people that, oh yeah, I have my little band, but we don't have enough money. We cannot put together a thing to go into a studio and spend our money into making a recording, because that was required. It was required a commitment of money, of effort, and are we worth it enough to go to spend all this money and to make a recording for ourselves? Only people that want to make a living out of it were up to do that. So, and that's the people that were making a honest, decent living out of the music. They were not big stars, but they were making a living. But now that is not possible because there are millions of people putting out recordings, and people that can play here, can play there. They don't care if they are paid. They don't care if they are, do you know what I mean? So there is not a middle class of musicians that can make a living out of it. And they are not gonna make a living out of 0.1% in Spotify, because their music, our music, is not played enough to make any consistent or any volume of money enough. You know what I mean? So that's difficult. It's very difficult because there is a big royalty up there that make the rest of us dreaming that that is possible. Sure, yeah, you can win the lottery if you buy a ticket, but technically it's very difficult to be low to that high percentage up there. And the rest of us, it's very improbable that we are gonna break the noise sound barrier and being in the other side. And it doesn't matter if you are this close, just about to jump into the other side, or just at the very bottom. Up here, nobody knows about you. The big public, they don't know about you. Doesn't matter if you are trying your best, if you are playing in little festivals, if you are making your records, if your records are fantastic. Doesn't matter. You are the same to that guy down there that is making his records in his house and has not a clue, you know? And that is a little bit of a bummer. But technology has allowed that to happen. You know what I mean? Some people back in the day were saying we should go to San Jose and that area of the Silicon Valley and burn down all those industries, because they have totally destroyed the music industries. And how, you know what I mean, with all these technologies and all these things, you know? And I think that is a little bit too much, but at the same time, when you think about it, it's like, well, there was so many people making a living out of this that now they are not. And it's absolutely impossible to make a living out of it. You can back down, you can go into the main root of everything. Oh, well, you have to do it because you like it. Sure. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yes, we are artists and we have to do it because we like it. We will love to make a living out of it, but I suppose that is something that we have to forget. And we have to do it because we like it. Okay, I'm gonna set my mind from now on in doing it because I like it. And I'm gonna put all these hours and this effort and this that because I wanna have a finished product that sounds like professional. It is just because I like it. I mean, that to me is very difficult to swallow. But hey, it's what it is. You know, I was reading Krishnamurti the other day saying, hey, if what you want is notoriety and become a successful or these or that's because maybe you don't like what you are doing. If you like your music, if you like what you are doing, if that's what it is, you don't need to become, you don't need to show, you don't need to be there, you don't need to any of that. You know what I mean? Maybe you need all of those things because you really don't like what you are doing. What you want is something else.
Yeah.
And they say, okay, well, all right, sure. Is artistry link or glue with the necessity of being adored and liked and applauded? I don't know. You're getting to a core situation there that is like, what is what it is? What is this actually? You know what I mean? Difficult to know. What I'm saying is like an engineer myself. I am an engineer. I don't think that I have any future as a professional, as things are going, unless I somehow are up there working with people that want to break that barrier of noise. You know what I mean? That they are just keep themselves trying and spending money and asking for loans to banks to pay the, you know what I mean? Sure. Yeah, I can be there and I'm gonna try to be there. But it's just like it's one of those things. Now, again, more or less is able to do their own recordings. You know what I mean? There is always a guy in the band that the bass player normally that knows how to run Pro Tools or that knows how to do that. You know what I mean? And then they made the recording and then they take it to Alfonso. They go, okay, Alfonso, can you mix it? Yeah, sure, yeah. But next time I will do the recording for free. So I can make a really great sound out of this. Because, yeah, you're saving money. You think you're saving money of not paying me for recording, but guys, YouTube doesn't give you all the solutions for where to place a microphone. It's not just about that. You know what I mean? Because all the information is out there, and people think that all the information is out there and all the tricks and oh, look, yes and not. After 20 years of putting the microphone here or there, when you really know the difference, you know. But hey, these are things that are happening in every single discipline of life now. It's like,
That's so true. I have a few questions. In any of your opinions, what do you think caused the various listening platforms to have gotten away with insult payments to artists like 0.0003 is ridiculous? Yeah, I don't know. Do you? You have an opinion of why they picked that?
why they need that? Because they
Why
want.
did they pick like 0.0003 to pay the artists?
I don't think they are thinking in a small economic, in a small business artists. They are thinking in big artists. So a big artist can generate lots of money. So if they give 0.1 to a big artist, that is going to be an enormous amount of money.
But who gets the remaining part of the, if it's 0.01, who gets the remaining part of
Well, there are shadow deals between these platforms and the record labels. The record labels are, I believe, they are making the big money. For them, there is a big difference with big generating business artists. There is a big difference if they are paying 0.0001 and 0.1, because they are making so much more money. All that difference is for them. Those are very private, very secluded deals that nobody knows about it. But in order for Spotify to have this infinite universal catalog of everything that is being created, they have to have the permission of the record labels, and the record labels are very smarty pants guys and the lawyers and the these, and those are the ones that fix those numbers. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, you need 1 million reproductions to make $10,000. You know, so yeah, but they are dealing with artists that are making billion spins. So you know what I mean? They are not thinking in me that I have 1,500 listens or spins. They can care less about artists like us. You know, they are thinking in those big numbers. That is a mega corporative money-making machine that, you know what I mean? I think that's kind of an explanation for all that.
Let's see. Joyce says if someone If someone doesn't read or write music but has a melody and lyrics for a song, can one submit a simple voice memo to an engineer, producer, arranger to get the ball rolling in choosing the ideal instrumentation and easily communicate the feeling of the song to be understood by the producer? How does a composer get on the same page with the people on the production end to keep the emotional intention and focus of their piece? Big question.
It's quite a big question. Yeah, I mean, yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Go for it, man.
I don't know what can I say. I mean, it depends. I mean, the best thing, if you can put together lyrics and melodies, you should get together with a friend that plays guitar or piano or whatever. And then you accommodate those lyrics in a better way. And then you can present that to an arranger or a producer or an engineer. You know what I mean? Because I mean, some engineers, they can do the job of like, oh, this and that, but that's not the role of an engineer. You know what I mean?
It's, I mean, I think Joyce, I mean, there's different avenues into that. You know, you could ask a friend, a musician friend, to, you know, finish off the song. You could ask an arranger to finish off the song and, you know, pull in the instrumentation, right? And or a producer, but I think even before the producer, probably those things would take place, wouldn't
Yeah,
you?
I think the best thing for writers that they are not musicians is to find a partnership with a musician of their like. You know what I mean? So they can write together and take care of, and give a song form to something that is more like lyrics. You know what I mean? What I would advise is just like, if you're going to see live music out there and you have favorite bands or favorite, ask one of those people, you know, and hey, would you like to give me a hand with these songs that I'm trying to put together? You know what I mean? And then put together those songs. Once that is done, that you have a song, okay, let's present this to a producer, an arranger, a band, someone that can put that together. You know what I mean? It's again working with someone else that can help you with that. And if you are working with more people, then more people can bring more ideas and more stuff. You know what I mean? It's not necessary that you have to be a full musician and play seven instruments to make songs. Not at all. It's just like get together with teams of people that everybody has its own little niche to put together. And in fact, that's one of the things that is being recommended again and again and more if you want to make a living out of it. It's just like to work and write with the biggest number of people possible so everybody can make that product, that song, reach a bigger number of contacts somehow. You know what I mean? To me, from my perspective, I'm so private and so that I like to write with myself, by myself. But there is people that work very well in teams.
There
They can
are.
break ideas, and some people is better for with hooks, some people is better with phrases, some people is better with concepts. They can work together and all of them benefit out of this teamwork.
What was I going to ask you? Oh, I was going to ask you. So you have five Grammys with a Mexican rock band, basically, or fun, Latin band, Mexican music, and they're very big, obviously, because otherwise they wouldn't have won Grammys.
They are gigantic. Yeah.
With them, how much input do you have? Do they basically do their body of music and then you do the engineering, you mix and master and whatever.
All right. So I have my five Grammys are exclusively with a band, Mexican American band called Los Tigres del Norte, which means the Tigers of the North. Okay, this is people that has been living in San Jose area, San Rafael, for around 50 years. They came from Sinaloa, from Mexico, and they crossed the river and all these adventures and all this, right? So I met the band with the band when the band was already gigantic. They have been in the Latin world. They have done everything. They have done movies. They were like a very famous musician, movie actors. They have like millions of followers. So I joined the band when they were already gigantic. Okay. And this is like 15 years ago. So yeah, we have made like, I don't remember how many records I've done with them, but we got five Grammys together, more than they have before. So I would like to present me with some merit because of all these Grammys, right? What they do, the genre that they do is a niche. I would say niche, but it's a niche that generates the biggest economic volume of the whole Latin industry. More than pop, more than rock, more than anything else. And this is regional Mexican music. Okay. And what they do is a genre inside that genre that is called norteño music. And norteño is kind of like a folk, polka Mexican tradition that then somehow electrified because there is an electric bass running there and there is drums. But then there is an accordion, and there is what they call a bajo sexto, which is a 10 strings acoustic guitar that is doing the contra. Tut, 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 tut. You know what I mean? And this is the kind of music that they do. They sort of invented because before that, it was just played in the squares of little towns, in festivities, and this and that. And they start doing it with electric bass that changed everything, and with drums, and they make this. They can produce this big rock sound out of a very acoustic genre. Do you know what I mean? So you have these powerful drums and bass and acoustic guitars and accordion. Sometimes it's saxophone, but it's most of the time accordion. These lyrics that are about all sort of adventurous traditions in the North Mexican lifestyle. It can talk about narco trafficants, narco corridos, people that cross the borders, love adventures of a very adventurous type of people. You know what I mean? Somehow people that epitomize American dream also, you know, that risk everything in their lives to cross the border and make a living and send money back. So they are very, they are legends and they are heroes of the people in the country. They are gigantic. It's probably the most important band in Mexico and is one of the bands and genres of music in the Latin industry that generates the biggest volume of money.
Can it
That's what, that's why there was a category specifically in the Latin Grammys and the American Grammys
Yeah.
that was
Yeah, yeah.
that. Not
Can
because of
do
anything, but because of the big volume of money.
you? Yeah. Could we listen to just like a minute or two of them? I don't want to like listen a lot, but what song, just to get an idea of what you're speaking of, what song, any particular song or?
Rumbo al Sur.
Okay, how do you spell that?
Rumbo al Sur.
Yeah. Rumba.
Or Rumbo. Yeah. RUMBO. AL Sur, SUR. Rumbo al Sur, yes.
Okay.
Or Jefe de Jefes.
Yeah, I mean, is this it? No, that's not it. That was
Has to
some
be
other.
Rumbo al Sur, Los Tigres del Norte.
Okay, and then
Or Jefe de Jefes.
oh, here we go. Okay. So this is just so we can get a little bit of an idea of what he's speaking of. Where did I just see it? Oh, right here? No, I just saw that. Hold on. Rumba Azul.
Rumbo al Sur, Los Tigres del
There
Norte.
we go. Okay. Oh. Okay,
Oh, what is
I don't know. It's like says they're closed. it's a Yelp thing. Okay.
That seems to
This.
be it. Yeah, that one probably.
There we go.
That's what it is.
Yeah. Okay, interesting.
It's very
Fun.
interesting, yeah.
Yeah.
Very interesting. You can like it or hate it, but it's what it is, yeah.
Yeah, I can
And
imagine.
I'm very proud of working with them, you know.
Yeah.
Inside the genre that they do, there are many different subgenres, you know.
Yeah.
More serious and more dancing styles, things like that. But it's regional Mexican music.
Yeah. It's great. I
Yeah.
mean, I like the idea too of, taking the original music, authentic music, and adding, some more, some modern things to it. And obviously it's a lot of people like it, obviously. Right?
So people, yeah, in the US and in Central and South America, they keep touring around. I mean, they are like the Rolling Stones of this thing, you know.
Wow.
They keep packing stadiums 2 days in a row, you know what I
Wow.
mean? 90,000
Wow.
people. It's just gigantic music. And they don't do tours per se. They keep going every weekend, every weekend, every weekend, every weekend. Then they took a month of vacations and they keep going every weekend. They don't do tours to present the new latest record. They keep
Yeah.
playing the same songs all the time. They do like 5, 6 hours concerts. Yeah, it's pretty fucking amazing. The people keep then throwing papers and say, "Oh, we are gonna play La Palomita for Juan Carlos," and they play La Palomita. Da, 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 you know, it's like they never stopped being what they were back 60 years ago when they were teenagers playing in little festivities of
Yeah.
Hamlets in the region that they were, you know what I mean?
Wow, quite a
Pretty
life.
amazing.
Yeah,
Yeah,
quite
very
a
amazing.
life. Okay, now I get to talk about your artistry as a musician.
Yes, I do many other kind of recordings or many kinds of music. Eh? I not just do the tears of
Oh
music.
yeah, and I mean your bio says you compose for movies and TV and stuff like
Yes,
that,
I do
right?
many, many things. Yeah.
Yeah.
Many eggs in my basket.
Yeah.
Especially because to make a living out of recording in these times is kind of like risking everything to one. Yeah.
So Alfonso has a group called the Blue Dolphins
Yes.
with his love, Victoria. And so how did that come about?
I was telling you before that I was already out of thinking of me as an artist. I was out. I had my dose back in my 20s in
Yeah.
Spain with this band. We try all this. I wasn't into that anymore. But then Victoria was here. She had a project with her sister, Zoe
Oh.
Scott. And she was writing partner with her. And at some point, she wanna make something by herself. I thought she was so talented. And I was pushing her to do it by herself. Oh, I don't have anybody that is helping me with this to play guitars and that. Okay. So I say, okay, I will help you put a first demo together. And then I help her to put, I play guitar and this and that, and programs and little beats and bites and this and that. And then after that first demo, okay, let's make a record. Let's make another record. So we have been making recordings since together. Somehow she awakened me, my artistry, and I enjoy very much doing those recordings. We have lots of videos too that we have made through the pandemics and before and after. And we have many songs right now that are ready to come out. We are seeing how can we do it because we would like to make a living out of it. You know what I mean? We
Don't
don't want to make
you guys perform live too, right?
We have been performing live, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's difficult to create attraction enough of brings people that is not your friends. You
Yeah.
know what I mean? That is difficult.
Yeah.
It's difficult in this city because this city is the Olympics. I mean, the best performers in the world are here. I
Yeah.
mean, you are gonna play. Sure, this weekend we can put together 70 friends that are gonna come and their friends and this and that. But if we play next weekend, it's very improbable that they are gonna come
Yeah.
again.
Yes.
So to go from that into start attracting people that are not your friends, it requires something else, you know.
Yeah.
And we never break through that.
That's that thing again,
That is exactly that.
that
I mean,
level.
if you are 20, you are in your 20s on the university or from the school of this or that are coming, that's great. But
Yeah.
that does not happen when you are not in your 20s. It's very
Right.
difficult to bring people that don't know you. You
Yeah.
know, and we have enjoyed some good quality radio time. We have been playing KCSN many times, you know what I mean? In different programs over there, but that doesn't mean that people is waiting for when is your next show to come and see you.
Yeah.
All these kinds of things have to be very, very well coordinated in order to make happen. So you've been in radio saying that you are gonna play next weekend, and then people go and see you, and then you create. It's very difficult to coordinate that. And when you have to put everything together by yourself, it's extra difficult, you know. We are two, we are self-contained. I can produce and make a record entirely by myself. Victoria writes, we sing, we track here. We make it happen like if we are bigger than we are. But in the end, we are a couple living in this Malibu Canyon thing, you know. And we enjoy it very much. And we have played in Mexico, we have played in the UK, we have when we go, we have gone to Spain, we have played there, and we have played in Los Angeles with bands that we have paid for them to play with us and all that. But I mean, that is a continued effort that if everything has to come out of your pocket, it's very difficult, you know what I
Yeah.
mean?
Yes.
We have done because when we put the records together, we spend our money into make, let's say, college radio campaigns. And we got to points that we have heavy rotation that people were playing our music. You know what I mean? And we say, oh, well, but the 2 months and a half budget was expiring. And we don't have another $10,000 to keep going in, to keep the role going. That's what a record label does. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And we were sending our music to blowers or to this, or we have reviews, and but that have to be keep going. We don't have that kind of money. So
Yes.
it's very difficult to break that barrier. And
Yeah.
yeah, sure, we keep playing once every 2 months. We could play more if we wanted, but we don't. And we are ready in another album. Maybe when we put the album out, we are gonna start doing more videos and more live performances and that.
Let's listen again. Yeah, I want to like look for. I mean, you have a lot of stuff on YouTube, right?
Yeah, we have lots of videos. From the
Yeah.
last album, we have every single song in a video that we produce and we put out, and all of it is recorded in the Santa Monica's area, in the places where we live.
So now, oh, I see. I'll be back. Wow, you look very hip on that cover.
Oh, thank you.
That
That
a song, or I mean, there's.
is a song, yeah. It's a song. You can look, I'll be back. The Blue Dolphin is a song that we record up there at the mountain trail. We went all the way up with the cameras and, well, I mean, with the cameras, with an iPhone. But there are ways to make an iPhone look fabulous.
Yeah, so this is one.
Yes.
And I mean, you tell me, you
Yeah, you
tell
can
me.
play that one.
Yeah, okay, good.
I'll be back. Not that one.
Not this one.
No, because that one is not a video, actually. That
Oh, okay.
one
So
is just a cover. It's a cover.
so
You can do the Blue Dolphins, I'll be back. In your Finder up there. If you want, play that one. I'll be back.
this it?
Now, yes.
Okay.
That's from the top of this mountain.
I'll be back when the summer is over. When the light turns gold and the days are shorter.
Alibu Canyon.
I'll be
Yeah.
back on the top of this mountain. Da-da.
These guys are so cool.
Yeah. Yeah. 2 years ago up there at the mountain, one sunset here in the Malibu Canyon.
Very nice. Good.
All our videos are shipped around here. Yeah.
Yeah, it's really
and
good.
That's me singing. But most of the time is Victoria singing or doing duets together, you know?
Yeah.
The last record, I start singing myself also. That is something that I thought I was never going to do it again. Why not?
Yeah. excuse me.
Yeah, drink some water.
Yeah. yeah, this is yeah, hi Banush. Yeah, that's on top of the mountain in Malibu.
Yes.
Yeah. Really nice. Good camera work too.
Well, you can do amazing things with an iPhone.
Yeah.
With any other telephone, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
We have a very good friend, Shannon Michael Terry, that I make recordings with him. He's an artist by himself.
Yeah.
He's an artist and exceptional musician also, that he helped us. And we don't spend much time. He start moving the iPhone from here, from there. We do like 4 or 5 takes. And then I put those takes in Premiere and I start editing. And I put effects and I put the 16 millimeters grain or whatever and make it look like it's been shoot with a real camera and this and that. But this is an iPhone, you know.
Really good.
Yeah, you can do things with technology again. You know what I mean? In order, back in the day, to do a video like that, you need 4 people, the cameras, the lighting, the DM, the back. And now we did it, you know, with the software and with an iPhone. So that's the technology.
Yeah, and it sounds great too. I mean, obviously, it sounds great. Did you sing along to tracks? Were you singing along to the tracks?
Oh, yeah, yeah. There was a bomb.
Is that what you were
there
doing? Okay.
In order to do a sing, listen, but I mean, we are not professionals at that.
Yeah.
We were doing no more than 5-6 takes at the most.
Yeah.
But then the editing goes into like, okay, well, let's try to get the chunks that at least we are lip syncing, you know what I mean?
Syncing, yeah.
Some
yeah.
videos are better, some videos not so much, you know,
yeah.
But that's the way I have to struggle a lot to put together the videos. Yeah.
Should I know that song? Is it an original or is it somebody else's?
No, that song is a full original. We do originals.
Very nice song.
All originals, yeah.
Now, didn't you show me a project where you were doing some old bands?
Yes, I explained to you, yeah.
Yeah.
Some friends of us, they start saying, oh, why don't you do some originals also? And we never thought of doing, some covers. And we never thought about doing covers. So at some point, okay, well, maybe we should start introducing songs, cover songs, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So we have been playing a cover of this band, this Scottish psychedelic folk band from the 60s called the Incredible String Band.
Yeah, yeah.
We did this cover forever, but we were playing it, but it's the last single that we put together.
Yeah.
A rendition of that song, that is a song called Painting Box.
Yeah.
This gorgeous song, very beautiful lyrics, and people seem to like it very much, the way we did it. Because of that and what these friends told us, we also did a cover of I Saw the Light of Todd Rundgren.
Yeah.
In the 50th anniversary of the release of the song and the album Something Anything of Todd Rundgren. Todd Rundgren, for me, is one of the top pop music American producers, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He went into the weird thing with his music, but he kept producing as engineer producer, great, great music during the 70s and that. And his weird music was amazing too. But this album is kind of like Something Anything is a very pop quintessential album of the 70s and has this song that is I Saw the Light, that I think is the song that you heard from us.
Yeah. That was a great song. And And just the video and the song and you guys, it just makes me want to come see you.
Yeah, some people really like it and really get where we are, you know what I mean? I mean, we are a couple and we play from this point of this point that emerged from the relation, you know, this complicity, you know what I mean? We project that, and we project uplifting content and encouraging people to do their best, and trying to convince people that this is full of light and good energy and positive vibrations, you know. We could, I personally could write from a very dark place, but sort of there, and we victorious right to project the beauty of world life, you know.
Two things. Roland said, I may be really off base, but the sound makes me think of the Flying Burrito Brothers and also of Bread, 70s groups. I like it. It's very spare, allows you to focus on the lyrics. Love
Thank you. We
it.
like soft rock a lot. It's something that maybe is not very fashionable or whatever. I don't care. I grew up listening to American soft rock, to those bands of the late 60s, early 70s, and also to the rock of the 70s, the classic rock. I mean, I don't have any unapologetically revisiting that. I don't care what people can think about all those
Like that,
bands. No, I
unapologetically.
like Fleetwood Mac, and I like Todd Rundgren, and I like Crosby, Stills and Nash, and I like Led Zeppelin, and I like many bands of the era. You know what I mean?
Yeah, me
I think it's
too.
one of the best music ever created. Deep music, deep lyrics, great adventures sonically at the time. You know what I mean? That's what is in my subconscious. I went through the whole punk new wave. In my early 20s, I went through the grunge and the electronic and this and that, but it's okay. That's somehow not in my subconscious. I like to use an acoustic guitar. I like harmonies, and I like the classic concept of how it
Ben My friend Banoush would like to find your cover of I Saw the Light. Is that on YouTube?
is in YouTube. Yeah, it's in YouTube and Spotify. We on YouTube, we didn't do a video out of I Saw the Light.
But it's on there.
Maybe in YouTube, yeah, I don't know, but it's definitely in all those platforms.
Yeah, so you can find that, Banoush. She said, she's a friend of mine. She lives in London. She says, gosh, I love all those bands. Can we be friends?
Yeah, we can be friends. Yeah, there is a video. There is a video for a painting box that we shoot in Topanga. Yeah, there is a video for a painting box, but we didn't do video for I Saw the Light. We should. Yeah, we were planning to do the video, but in the end, we didn't. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, but isn't for certain in Bandcamp. We like to recommend Bandcamp more than any other platform because it's full definition audio. It's beautiful. The lyrics are there. The all the information. You know what I mean? It's not just a spinning in sound. You know.
Bandcamp is the hippest platform around, really.
I think so. Yeah. I think that's right.
So what are you doing with your time these days? Are you doing more engineering or more artisting, or what are you
I'm
doing?
doing more engineering. The nature of the freelancing thing, when you are not a sought after producer that is all the time working like hell, is like you have ups and downs. You have seasons that you are working a lot, and then you are not working that much. And I try to drive through those ups and downs. When I'm not working, I have time to make music. And when I'm working, I don't have time to make music. So you know what I mean? That's the way I'm using my time. Lately, I've been working a lot since the beginning of the year. It's very interesting that when the more you work, the more time you have to do things. Very interesting. Sometimes when you are not working, you seem to have not time to do anything.
I
You
know,
know,
that's true.
it's
That's
very
it's very
weird.
odd. Yeah, it's very odd.
Yeah, it's a very weird. Oh yeah, getting the in the passion of accomplishing things and finishing things and doing things, and you schedule your time better.
Yeah.
When you are not doing anything, it gets very difficult to start the engine to, okay, I'm gonna sit at the piano and I'm gonna write a song now. You know, like, yeah.
Yeah. I know. It's that's a very I've noticed that too. It's very odd.
Oh,
It's
there
like
is that.
I'm
Yeah.
super busy. I'm getting a whole bunch of stuff done and you know, people can ask me for things. I work on that. And then when I actually have space, I feel like I don't have enough time for everything or anything.
Yes, yes.
It's such an odd thing, isn't it? Very odd.
Is. Time
Yeah.
does not exist.
Yeah.
It's a creation of our minds. That's where our
Yeah.
gurus think, right?
Yeah.
That's a clear concept. You don't have time, but you create time to accommodate all those things.
Yeah.
And then you have lots of time, but you don't seem to accomplish anything.
Yeah.
How that works, you know, it's.
Yeah, it's really strange.
Yeah, it is.
yeah, I went to Kulaks last night. Yeah, last night. Did I? Speaking of time, I
Oh, yeah.
think it was last night. And I saw a really fun singer, drummer, DJ from Kansas City named David Bess. And yeah, it was really fun. It was he's very jazz, Kansas City, New Orleans style, you know. He writes a lot of very cool material and has kind of a, you know, down home raspy voice, and his drumming is really
Oh.
great. Great groove, and you know, it was really fun. Fun to
Singer and
see.
drummer.
Yeah. And a singer
Yeah.
and a
I want to
composer.
see you play in live. When are you playing next?
I'm not playing that much this month, but I'm playing on April 23rd. It's a little farther away for you though, in Eagle Rock.
Ah, well. I thought that you were going to say Gardenia or something like that.
No, Eagle Rock, and I'm playing the music from an old record of mine called Secret Life, which I actually did at Kulaks last month, and it was so satisfying. I mean, that record was from about 22 years ago,
Oh.
and it was I wrote most of the music, and it was in this funny period where I had left my husband,
Okay.
and I was
For a
I just
while.
yeah I was just I was just like bubbling up with songs, you know. And then they weren't kind of my typical songs. It was kind of what I call alternative. And I got a band together, and I just rehearsed the material. And then magically, while we were doing that, somebody called and asked me if I wanted to do a record, which hardly has ever happened. And so it turned out to be this record, Secret Life. But the band at Kulaks just made such beautiful music out of it. It was
What
so
band
much
do you
fun.
have?
John Leftwich on bass, and Brad Rebuchen on guitar, Todd Hunter on piano, and Chris Wabich on drums. So we're going to do it again April 23rd, and
In
it's
Eagle Rock.
just wow, I just love it. In Eagle Rock at St. Barnabas Church.
I
It's
have become a big fan of Todd
like
Hunter. I like his records very much, and the way he plays, the way
isn't
he
he
talks.
good? He's so sensitive and
Voice
beautiful.
leading, it's just like, oh my God.
Yeah, he did the amazing things with my music. It
Yes.
was I was really turned
Have you
on.
recorded together?
I don't think we have. No. Nope.
Well, you should in the next future.
Yeah. Yeah, he's really good. I'm yeah. I'm trying to finish up these three records now, and
Three only.
three, and I'm also recording a new record in June in Korea.
In
Just a tape.
Korea. So
Yeah,
you
with
are
a
going to
show.
Korea? Wow. Say hello to him.
I will. You know, we had done a duo record previously called Bohemian, which was very adventurous. And so he wanted to do another duo record too. So yeah, he's being extremely generous to me. He's flying me over from Japan. I'll be in Japan. And he's flying me over, putting me up. He got a gig for like every night and a recording
Wow.
session. So it's very
So
nice.
you are going to be in Japan.
I'll be in Japan from May 13th to the beginning of June.
Vacations or
No, all working. I'm going to the Hiroshima area, the Osaka area, and Tokyo. So gigs and teaching.
Oh, that's
And
fantastic.
yeah, it's the first time. I used to go every year, but at the pandemic, of course, I stopped. So this is the first time since the pandemic started that I'm back.
Wow.
And you know, part of me is getting older and going, oh, do I really want to travel? And then the other part of me is like, of course you do, you know, and you can't stop going to Japan, you know.
So how is the record that I know coming along? Is finished in the end or?
No, I mean, the what is waiting, and I guess in the process, he's arranging for strings
Ah, he has not
and
completed the arrangement
recording.
or recording of the.
Right. I mean, the vocal part and the trio part, of course, with your help, is done, and then so he just has to add the strings.
Yes.
So hopefully that'll get done in the next. I don't know where he is with that. He's very busy in Korea. He does a lot of
I
K-pop.
imagine because
Yeah.
he's so talented.
He's very talented.
I enjoy every single note that the guy giving the piano. It was just like so tasty too, you know.
Yeah.
And then he told me that he knew a good acquaintance of me from Spain in Berkeley, Santandreu, which is a fabulous saxophone player. He said, "Oh, I was friends with Santandreu. Santandreu, wow, he's quite of a personality, big personality in my town in Valencia."
Oh, really?
Yeah, they study together in Berkeley. Yeah, so it's a small world. It's
Yeah.
very good sometimes. These coincidences, you know what I mean?
I know. It's all over the place, man. All you have to do is move forward, you know?
I would like if you can pass me his email because Dennis passed me his email, but I somehow it was not there was some mistake in the spelling or something that it could not
Okay.
get there. Yeah.
I'll do that. I'll do that. Yeah. Yeah. Banush is saying time management is such a challenging task. Any advice on how to best divide the time between production and performance, especially as a newcomer, which she is.
Well, advice.
No.
There is, to me, there is no more advice as discipline and persistence.
Yeah.
So discipline of throwing yourself there every time, every day at same time, even if you don't like it, go there, do the job again and again on persistence. Persistence is just like keep knocking at the door, keep trying it, and keep going for it. You know what I mean? This is just like a like an old martial arts thing. You know what I mean? Perfection through repetition. You know what I mean? It's only after repeating and repeating and repeating when you do things with eyes closed and seemingly and without any effort. You know, or it's not a. This is not a hedonistic thing. I don't think creation and music is an hedonistic thing. Oh, I have my whiskey and I go on. No, I don't think it's that. And especially in some more demanding discipline as jazz is, you need to do your chops and you need to rehearse and you have to have your vocals there and you know, nurture yourself. It's more like a kind of like athletic thing than sport thing. You have to train, you have to stay strong in all sides of it, right?
Yeah, I think to me, two things come to mind too. One is to really live with the idea of joy involved with all your actions, all of them, you know, even practicing the stuff that seems just repetitious and boring, still joy, bringing in joy, you know, because as you say, the more you practice something, the better you get at it. So if you're practicing with joy, you're practicing actually using joy. And the other thing is, I read something which was really cool. I forget her name. She's a good writer. Anyway, she said, creativity is curiosity. And I really like that idea. You know, I'm curious about how this little line goes. That's you're creating.
Yes.
You know, it's not a brain surgery, you know. It's an enjoyment, and you can practice it, and you can, like, I know a guy who, he just says, he puts on the timer for a half hour every day, and he writes, no, whatever.
Yes.
No matter what, he just writes for a half hour every day. Sometimes it goes longer, and that's fine, but it never goes shorter, and he never misses a day.
But that's a part of the discipline I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. You have to expose yourself to that.
Yeah.
Some days you don't want to do it, Some days it's easier, but it's the accumulation of the days that you didn't want and the days that you do that keep that thing going, and that is noticeable. I think it was Paco de Lucía, the great guitar player, or I don't know if it was John McLaughlin or one of them. They said, "When I don't play one day, I notice myself that I didn't play for one day." When I didn't play for 2 days, my guys in the band, they noticed.
And
when I was playing without 3 days, the people knew it. I noticed that in myself. When I've been sitting in the piano every day, 30 minutes, doesn't matter. In the end, after a week, I'm playing like, oh, this is the way I would like to play. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I've been erratic that today 3 hours, but tomorrow and past tomorrow don't. And then another 2 hours, and you go nowhere. You know what I mean? It's sort of a discipline of tuck, 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 tuck. Of exposing yourself in to be there with the instrument, with your notepad. You know what I mean? And when you do that, there is a point that is when the force start going through you, when you start channeling. Because you are exposing yourself to that energy up there, to that pool of whatever it is, and that pool sees that you are presenting yourself there again and again and obstinately again there, and then you start pouring. You know what I mean?
I do.
You can't come out of a 2 hours pillar of nowhere. You know what I mean?
This going back to this writer, and now I remember at least, I forget her name, but she wrote Eat, Pray, and Love, and she wrote Big Magic after that, which was a very good. Banush, I don't know if I ever told you about that book, but you should read that book, Big Magic. this woman started writing, you know, many years ago, and she committed to writing every day, forever, you know. And she did. Every single day she wrote. So she wrote this great Eat, Pray, and Love, and which became a big movie with Julia Roberts. And then afterwards, you know, she was continuing to write. And she said, people would say, oh, my God, what are you going to write now? You know, I mean, how can you compare to that? You know, which could have stopped her. But, you know, she kept writing. And this book, Big Magic, is really great. It kind of gives you permission to be creative. And there's a great story in there where talking about what you were just talking about, like the muse, right? So you have to be there ready for the muse, because if you're not, the muse moves on. Yeah. And to illustrate that, she had a great story that she had a contract with a publishing house, and but she was going through a lot of personal issues in her life for several years, and so she kept moving it to the back burner, you know. And she went to some meeting, you know, like a big production meeting event, and she met another writer who she had admired but had never met, and they had lunch, and this other woman was writing that idea, and it was a very unusual idea, and this other woman was actually, you know, publishing it and everything. And this the original writer that I'm talking about realized, you know, yeah, the muse, it kept giving it to me, but I kept putting it off. So the muse moved on with the same, you know, the exact same idea, you know. I thought that was a really great little story, you know.
It's a big story, little story, yeah. Very interesting. Well, that's creativity, yeah. I mean, you were pointing curiosity, yeah. You have to be like, try this way, try that way. How it's going to come if I go this way, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's so interesting. Somehow there is a moment that you have to fix it and pass page, because you cannot be eternally deciding, oh, I like this way, and I like this way too, or I like this way now, and I like this way later. Okay, both are okay. Next page. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because there is the thing coming, and then there is the intellect and the mind that has to take the decision. I think that's where we are in essence. You know what I mean? Yeah. The ones that take the decision. You know, we are presented by our minds with many, 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 many options, right? Because that's the nature of mind. The nature of mind is to present us with, if I do this, if I do that, but if I do this and I do that, blah, 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 all these variations. And that's and then the one driving the horse in is like, okay, I go with this. You know what I mean? That's who we are, the ones taking the decision.
Yeah.
The mind is only presenting us. We are tapping these energies from up there. You just let it flow, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Same time, we are taking the decision of like, include this or include that, or make it in this way or make it that way, you know?
Yeah.
It's very interesting. All this creative world is so beautiful and enigmatic. And it's such a mystery, you know? It's such a mystery. It's beautiful that it's a mystery, you know?
Yeah.
I like it. To me personally, I feel very difficult to present myself to fix these channeled things. You know what I mean? To give it a structure and to complete and to finish and to make it something tangible and solid out of something that is so ethereal, you know?
Yeah.
It happens to me, for example, when I play piano.
Yeah.
I'm a horrible piano player, but sometimes I have beautiful, enjoyable moments when I'm not questioning or second-guessing myself, and I start channeling, and I bring gorgeous melodies that even I like myself. I like them. Oh, wow, who's playing this? You know what I mean? And then I could go into, okay, let's make a song out of this. Or you can say, hey, I'm just channeling and it's coming and it's going. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I like to let it go too. You know what I mean? Make that my very private experience of that. I don't have the urge of having to make it solid, you know?
Yeah.
Of this dimension.
Very interesting.
Some people is just looking for that moment to bring it to life and show to other people, to others, you know? I don't have that urge. For me, it's I don't have the urge of writing
for
fixing ideas in order to be shown.
Yeah. I know. I'm not like that either. I always think my lyrics are very ethereal, and And I'm always kind of surprised when composers like my lyrics that I've put to their compositions, because they're kind of, with double entendres and, I took at least one writing class that actually made me come out with a great lyric in this one song that I just loved. But and that was and but then, I just haven't gone back to really studying. I think I tried again, but frankly, I didn't agree with the teacher's perception of what I was writing. They asked for these particular ideas. I came up with what I had in me, and they wanted to kind of guide it somewhere, and I think more for commercial value. And it was like, no, I don't think so.
It's very interesting that too. People like it's very opinionated and people think about everything, you know what I mean? They are gonna have an opinion and an idea of what you are doing. That's very interesting. And that's part of being an artist, right? You are gonna open your heart and you are gonna explain. You're submitting yourself to critique and to opinion and to this and to that. That's a part of artistry that is very important and very of what being an artist is. You know what I mean? That somehow, if you think of what I say of Krishnamurti, that, well, you should do it for yourself. You know what I mean? If you choose to open your heart and to be exposed there and be seen and be there, you are exposed to being heartbroken. Because everybody is going to have an opinion of what you are doing. And maybe that can hurt you because you are exposing your inner, more sensitive, more you that it is. You know what I mean? In the creative. And so some people say, no, I don't want to expose myself. I want to keep it for myself. And some people thinks and feels the obligation of, I have to submit myself to the people because I create this and this is being channeled through me to be shown. You know what I mean? It's a very interesting, but everybody's gonna have an opinion and not everybody like the same kind of tea. That's in the
Also,
same.
in all of life, I think one of the major lessons in life is to be able to express yourself and not particularly care of the response. And if you get a negative response, it shouldn't change your feeling about what you feel. I think that's one of the major lessons in life, no matter what you're doing, at whatever job, family, friends, lovers, everywhere. But we're so lucky to be doing that in art, because we get a lot of other wonderful things, with this attached to this lesson,
I think, yeah, I think it's very challenging. I mean, life is very challenging and creativity is very challenging. That sense, like, and what you are saying is, of course, that's the way it is. I mean, you have to go with it. This is me. This is the way I see it. This is my vision, and I'm not gonna change this because this or that or that or that person is saying, oh, you should try to give some concessions in order to be more wide. Like it or to be more commercial or this and that. Well, yes and not. You know what I mean? You have to follow your commission. I absolutely think that we are, I mean, some people have a more strong armor than others. You know, some people have a very thick skin and we others have some very light skin that everything affect us. Just a hint of we don't like you, destroy our life forever. And we don't write any more songs. You know what I mean? And people is open to critique. Oh, that's what you think. I don't give a fucking whatever. You know what I mean? I follow my path. You know what I mean? And there is other people that have soft skin, but they keep pose of arrogance and like, I don't give what you're thinking. But they are sensitive to what they are thinking. You know what I mean? But definitely you have to go what you think, because what you think is what makes you unique, right? And with other things, it's like make you sound like someone else, because that someone else has been listened by others, and that will put you in that niche, and then you will be understand better or whatever. Sure, understood better or whatever. But go with yours, because that's where you are. It's your uniqueness what is gonna make you special and really appreciate it. It's meant to happen, you know. Middle path in artistic creation, I don't think is a good thing, you know. You cannot persuade everybody to like you. So the best thing is to be true to yourself. And hey, you know, some people like jazz music, some people like AC/DC. But not everybody's gonna like jazz music. Nobody is gonna like this kind of jazz music. Some people like just saxophone music, you know. So we cannot pretend to like to be liked by everybody, you know. So the sooner we learn that, the better.
I mean, this brings me back to what we were talking about earlier, of the level that we're not going to really get over. Most of us, we're not going to be in this upper level of world-renowned artists. We're going to be in this, and kind of ties in with that. It's like you're either happy with that or fine, let's say fine with that, or you might as well do something else. If you're not okay with that, do something else, because it's life. And that's why, meditation and this kind of meditating thinking, from the gurus, and this is why that is so important, because you observe what's going on, good, bad, ugly, beautiful, and you just observe it and witness it, and that's it. It's just, there's no need to get judgment going, or hitting yourself over the head, or hating the other person, or whatever. There's no need for that. So yeah, it's an
I think it's a
interesting
little bit of acceptance. It's a little bit of
acceptance.
acceptance. You know what I mean? You have to accept and be grateful of what you have. You know what I mean? If it means to happen this way or that way, it's meant to happen. And if not, it's not. It doesn't matter. In the end, do it because you love it, because you like it. You know what I mean? If it's going to be rewarded at a notoriety level and this and that, it's okay. Maybe you're not gonna like that. You know what I mean? Maybe you are dealing with this and with that, but maybe you have it and you don't like it. And destroy your life and destroy everything that, you know what I mean? But sometimes I think that also to myself. You know, in the old world, it's better to think that what I have is what it is and make this worth it, you know what I mean, and enjoy it. Because hey, who knows? Maybe I got that and I lose this, and that is a fucking hell. I don't think fame and success and all that, all those things are making anybody happy. In fact, I think all the people that he's been has been poor devils in the end. All those things have destroyed their lives. I don't think there is a single one that could keep as a normal person, you know what I mean?
Well, that's why, that's another reason I like this Mexican group that you have the Grammys with, or just how you described it, because it sounds like they're bringing who they've been in the past, and just bringing it to the people and sharing. I mean, 5-hour concerts, you know, and doing requests, and and then the subject matter is joyous and or you know, you know, that kind of feeling. Wow, what could be better than that? You know,
nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing. I don't know. This is a mystery, but there are rules there that there are lessons that are interesting to get. The sooner the better. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, we should not do this to be successful and this and that and blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? We should find solace in our own satisfaction more than anything else, you know?
Yes.
Hey, and if it's meant to happen, it will happen.
Yes.
Because I can tell you this theme of the Grammys, I didn't came to the US to make myself a super engineer or to make Grammys. I know guys that came here to get successful and get Grammys because the Grammys this and the Grammys that. And they went Sunset Boulevard, up and down, making sessions, knocking doors, all the lies, doing the work, doing the math in order to get there.
Yeah.
And didn't make it.
Yeah.
Didn't have a Grammy.
Right.
Me, myself, I came here without that perspective at all. Someone gave my phone to someone. Someone gave me a phone call. I say this or I say that, blah, blah, blah. And look, I have 5 Grammys.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If it's meant to happen, it's going to happen, no matter what you try. And you can spend your life torturing yourself. Oh, I want this world. And not having it.
Yeah.
And do nothing and having it.
Yeah.
So just like, leave it to God.
Yeah.
Leave it to the universe. If it, you know what I mean?
I do.
But that enjoyment that you may happen, that you may have, that is not going to, nobody's going to take you that. If that's what it is, the enjoyment, you know?
So, you know what? It's been 2 hours.
You mean 2 hours? That's why the telephone is sounding. Right now. Who is it?
Thank you so much for, I knew it was going to be a great conversation, but it has been. And thank you. It's been really cool, wonderful conversation.
Thank you, Cathy. Yeah. I like you very much.
You're such a doll. You're great, I know. You and Victoria, when I met Victoria, I was thinking about that. I met Victoria and it was like, sister, you know. So you guys, I love you guys. And I hope to see you more. It's just great. Anybody who wants to find Alfonso, I put his website in there too. And, you know, or you can contact me. I'll give you his information, but whatever. But thank you so very much.
You are so welcome. I enjoy every second. And keep me posted of your whereabouts. Maybe we can go together to a concert or something that you think that we should.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks a lot. Bye, you guys. And next week, guys, on Monday, I have Stephanie Spruill. She is one of those 20 feet to stardom kind of singers. She's very interesting. Has had a really interesting career. So looks like I'm doing Mondays again. You know, I mean, still. Although I am going to Japan and Korea, and I won't be doing it for that month. It's mid-May to mid-June. But before that, I will, and after that, probably. So, guys, for those of you in town, I have a gig April 23rd, which is a Tuesday night. It's a free concert. It's being sponsored by the Musicians Union, and it's in Eagle Rock. And that's it. Hope you have a great day.